Afternoon, everyone. I'm so happy to be sharing this panel with Stuart and Sagar here. We are going to be talking about diversity and inclusion, and not only from the gender perspective, but also looking at various tangents in where, diversity and inclusion needs to be talked about, such as technology, education, entrepreneurship, and other fields. Absolutely honored to be sharing panel with Stuart and Sagar. Just a brief introduction about them. Stuart is a chief investment officer at Simply Ethical, United Kingdom, over 16 years of experience in non-executive positions across education, housing, and social care. This has included several board positions and also roles chairing finance committees, vice chair of school trustees, and the chair of major social housing organization. He's an experienced wealth manager with a demonstrated history of working in investment management industry, skilled in asset management, retirement planning, investment advisory, and mutual funds. Recent roles have also been to be founder and work with a number of foundations looking at environmental and social impact and how new technology, especially blockchain, is developing new areas and meeting future needs. Welcome, Stuart, to the panel. We're absolutely honored to have you with us.
Thank you very much.
I'll move on to Sagar. Sagar is an advocate of Supreme Court of India. He deals with intellectual property rights, law of taxation, PMLA, anti-corruption laws, laws of arbitration and dispute resolution, property disputes, and criminal law, especially white-collar crimes. Welcome, Sagar, to the panel. Absolutely honored to have you with us. I will get started with Stuart first. If you'd like to, deep dive into, the role that several roles that he's playing and something about his work that we should know about.
Oh gosh, well, okay. As I think you've kind of given me a very good potted history of my background. In fact, whilst listening to that, Anna Radha, I kind of didn't even recognize myself. So it's wonderful. Thank you very much for that. I mean, my background is primarily finance-based. So my role in terms of impact and working in different types of environments tends to come through from the finance and kind of banking background. And the reason I've kind of approached that from that angle is one, because of my obviously experience over the last couple of decades working in that sector, and obviously in the wealth management as well as different other areas. And we have a great belief that that finance is the first domino to fall. So when trying to achieve something of impact, certainly around looking as we are today on diversity, et cetera, we see finance as being the kind of the first lever, the first domino to fall. And I think that's a really important perspective. I've got a few things I'd like to kind of go through, if that's okay, just to kind of pick up as a starting point. So whenever I talk on a panel, I always tend to bring a quote. And I thought it would be quite appropriate to use a quote here from Mahatma Gandhi, who said once, "Our ability to reach unity and diversity will be the beauty and the test of our civilization." So I think I've got to kind of just maybe half a dozen points just to quickly kind of go through, just so I can help in terms of us creating kind of a strong conversation with this. The Sustainable Development Goals from the United Nations have given us quite a clear steer on how important we see diversity as something we thrive on. Goal 5 clearly talks about achieving gender equality, and Goal 10 talks about reduced inequalities. But many of the goals have a kind of interrelationship with each other, tackling how we'll benefit by grasping our diversity and using this to our benefit as a global society, as well as kind of communities around the world. However, we also need to, well, I think we kind of need to recognize this kind of thriving on diversity and how this will have an impact on other goals. Like, for example, just Goal 1 and Goal 2, where we, no poverty and zero hunger, and how this kind of diversity kind of arrangements in terms of developing and building upon that can actually help combat and help those be achieved. I think we also need to understand the detail behind diversity as how it offers challenges as well as opportunities. I mean, we see diversity in a wide range of areas. And I know, Sagar, this is something you'll probably pick up with shortly, but things we always talk about gender equality and diversity. We talk about ethnicity and geographic, actually. I mean, geography in terms of regions and different perspectives. But actually, in some ways, in our developed kind of global world we live in, we also need to think about also kind of and see us more in terms of social areas, so around kind of education, technology, and also more cultural. And that's something which obviously I think we'll probably pick up during this panel. There's a greater need to understand what exactly diversity means to communities. And I think the impact of a deeper understanding will mean and what this actually means to society will help. And I think with that great understanding, we'll see this kind of perception change. And I think the chance for increased inclusivity, which is something which is key to being able to achieve this. I know, Anuradha Janajal, you're seeing how technology is creating kind of opportunities and the impact of a kind of, you know, around, I think is it smart? You have this kind of vision as sustainable, measurable, agnostic, resilient, and timely, if I remember correctly.
That's right.
I've been practicing that one. You know, and the use of things like, you know, this is Janajal, for those who aren't aware, you know, is around you know, the water ATMs and this kind of this largest decentralized water distribution network in India. And it makes water accessible and it's affordable to everyone and also in a sustainable manner. But also it has this kind of aspect around providing jobs and training to create local social entrepreneurs. So it brings in this diversity in different areas to be able to develop that. And I think that's a really good example of how we can see thriving on diversity as a really good attribute. So here it's about recognizing diversity exists, but also we need to also see how this supports allow it to thrive. So, I mean, my background as I spent around the finance sector recognizes we need to see how finance actually can be a lever, how it can bring diversity and recognition to the benefit of areas like ethnic subgroups and to the forefront, see how society can benefit from such diversity as well as protect their identities. And I think that's key. One of the things that often see is this kind of bringing people together, but actually we often then start to lose identities. And I think that's something we need to work with. It may be seen as a bit of a dichotomy. And I think certainly in the past it's seen as a bit of a dichotomy, but actually this rich mix of differences is now being seen, I mean, especially in Asia, my time in Asia, as diversity actually offers strengths. So inclusiveness is now key in allowing different voices to be heard. I quite like, it was something I've read actually in a book by a close friend of ours, Nick Gowing and Chris Langdon, something called Thinking Unthinkable. And he talked about how, you know, kind of diversity offers this alternative voice that provides a perspective that achieves a greater sum of the total. It brings a different view on a problem and a different way to resolve it. And I think this may bring kind of in terms of cultural perspectives, local views and important unconventional thoughts and something how it can be resolved and done in a more kind of healthy manner. And just finally, I mean, I know just I was reading yesterday about a project in Malaysia that's coming through, which is at a Wakaf in Malaysia Trust. And there they're looking at how broader impact finance can be brought to the forefront of social and economic issues. And part of that is around kind of evolving diversity. So just to finish, I have another quote, actually, just finally, an author called Ola Joseph. He said, diversity is not how we differ, but diversity is about embracing one another's uniqueness. I will pause there.
Stuart, that was amazing. I mean, I completely agree when you said that one SDG. I mean, SDGs are not really operating in silos, right? The moment you make an impact on one, you're making an impact on other one as well. You know, considering that, you know, I work a lot in the impact space and especially water, which is SDG 5, providing, you know, clean drinking water to everybody. And you would be surprised to know that water alone impacts 9 out of 17 SDGs that there are. There can't be a smart city without clean drinking water. Water also helps in, you know, improving gender equality, because women and water, they're inseparable. If there's no clean water at home, it is often women who are given the charge of getting it, right? So similarly, you know, as far as education is concerned, in India, a lot of children are not able to make it to school. And I'm sure that this topic is something which is very close to Stuart's heart, talking about education, and because they don't have safe drinking water at home. So, you know, I work a lot in the impact space, and as somebody, I'm also India's top 3 marketers under 30. And, you know, with the responsibility that, you know, even the brand communications has to be very, very inclusive. Today, when we are talking about, we have to be very, very responsible what kind of, you know, communications that we are putting up. Just bringing to and adding to what Stuart, you know, mentioned, I think it is also very, very important to talk about, you know, women in entrepreneurship. Right now, women only account for 3% of GDP. Women entrepreneurs only account for 3% of GDP in the country, and they're given less than 2% of funding. And so I think it is very important, according to McKinsey's report, it has often, you know, it's often visible that, you know, companies with the most diverse workforce, they outperform the others. So, you know, just talking about the entrepreneurship space, I will, move to Sagar now. And I think Sagar, diversity and inclusion is something which is very, very close to him. And I would like to, put his thoughts on how we can look at this, from a tech space, especially, when we are talking about, the regulatory situation in India regarding crypto. RBI attempted a ban in 2018. People think that if crypto is being, if it lands in the wrong hands, then it might create a problem. But the transactions are being recorded on blockchain, right? So India is a creator economy, and people can actually use crypto to purchase NFT. We recently saw Amitabh Bachchan launching the NFT for Sholay and, a lot of his creative assets. And so use case could get mitigated if we don't allow crypto as a means of payments. But I think Sagar would be the best person to answer and put his weight on this topic. Over to you, Sagar.
Thanks, everyone. And hello, Anuradha and Stuart. I'm glad to be part of this panel. And on the topic, diversity, and especially technological diversity, because that's also something which must be and is very important to achieve all the other type of diversities which we are talking about, whether it's clean and affordable energy, whether it's sanitation and drinking water, whether it's decent work and economic growth, whether it's infrastructure development. All these, in some way or the other, are definitely dependent on technology, because that is something which makes the whole thing a lot easier and a lot efficient. And moreover, it makes sure that the benefits which are to be given, they reach to the person who is standing at the last mile, or is the last person standing in the queue. Now, technology is something which helps to bridge us that gap and make sure that we reach, or the resources reach, to that last person. So that's the importance of having technology as part of diversity. On the crypto issue, I definitely think that initially crypto is something which can be used as a currency, but it can definitely be an investment avenue, or it can be held an asset to begin with. It being used as a currency, now that's something which has its own legal implications and legal undertones or overtones on it, because currency, as we have traditionally known right from the ages when kings used to rule anywhere in any part of the world, currency is something which has been under sovereign control. So I've always pitched in, or I've always put in a lot of thought as to if there can be any global understanding or any global agreement on the regulation of crypto, then probably we may see a day where crypto can be used as a currency, because then in that case, every country would be willing and ready to cede some of its sovereign control on some aspects of currency. But that is something which is, according to me, not very likely in the very near future. But I'm sure the kind of popularity and the kind of widespread usage crypto has, I'm sure one day definitely the global regime or the global regulations on crypto are not something which is very far away, but at the same time, it's not going to happen in the near future. And when I talk specifically about India, in the crypto space, as we all know, India has the highest number of crypto owners in the world. So it has already become quite popular. But we need to see whether the popularity is for crypto being used as a currency or crypto being held as an asset. Because my personal experience has been, and I've seen people who are crypto owners, they prefer investing in crypto as an asset because it's a highly volatile asset. So when you gain really big in no time. And when you lose, then of course, it's the flip side. But people are ready to take that calculated risk. with the crypto. So summing up my crypto point, I definitely think we should wait for the bill, the regulation Bill 21, crypto regulation Bill 21 is due to be presented in the Indian Parliament this winter session. I'm sure there will be some section or some clause in that particular act which would empower the government to further frame rules and come out with notifications. So let us wait for that. Let the fine print come out. And I'm sure all the legal minds and all the industry people would be very keen to see what the fine print of the bill is. But at the same time, crypto being used as a currency is something in India which I do not think is going to happen in the near future. But yes, sometime later, or say, for example, 10 years or 5 to 10 years down the line, this is something which government cannot just ignore for a very long period of time, because that's the whole uniqueness of crypto, that it can be used as a currency to purchase goods and services.
Sagar, so, just adding to what you're saying, and so when somebody is transacting in crypto, the transactions are getting recorded on blockchain, right? So what is government so apprehensive about? I mean, you're closest to the matter, and I thought that you might be the best person to answer it. That, I mean, you can still do bank transactions, and you might not have so much of clarity since every transaction is not so transparent. But when it comes to crypto, there's more transparency. So what is that, what is this whole apprehension about, that getting into the bad hands or,
I don't know. See, I cannot speak for the government here, but from a logical and a legal point of view, I guess that the reason here is that the sovereign control on currency is something which is very, very vital to any government's functioning. Now, to have crypto be used as a currency, now if I compare it with the banking transactions, say for example the normal wire transactions which we make day in and day out, even they are subjected to sovereign control. And right. The RBI monitors those transactions on a regular basis. Now, this is my guess, it may be right, it may be wrong. That sort of control and supervision is not yet being figured out at the government level with respect to the blockchain technology or the crypto transactions, because that is something which is very technically advanced. And I definitely feel it's the sovereign control on printing currency and regulating the whole banking sector which would need a relook or a reform from the beginning. Like to say, for instance, the RBI Act would have to be amended, the Banking Regulation Act would have to be amended to make sure that crypto is used as a currency or is acceptable as a legal tender. So that is something which would require a lot of thought and a lot of effort on every wing of the government's part, which is responsible for economic and banking affairs. But at the same time, I personally think to begin with, even if crypto is being allowed to be held as an asset, that is something in the positive direction. That is something, because there are countries which we know of who have banned foreign cryptocurrencies completely, and they are probably coming out with their own digital currencies. But at least in India, there will be some private cryptocurrencies which would not be banned, but at the same time, they can only be allowed to be held as an asset, and they would not be accepted as a legal tender. So to begin with, I think we are going in the right direction, but where we reach is something which would depend upon the path which we follow as policymakers or whatever policy decisions are taken.
Definitely.
Can I just have a quick comment on that? Sure. Because I think one of the critical perspectives around Cryptocurrencies come in all different shapes and sizes. So we could talk about diversity in cryptocurrencies as well, actually, in terms of, you know, from the utilitarian kind of perspective right through to the kind of the equity-based kind of perspective as well. And you know, Bitcoin kind of has driven this whole kind of motorway kind of through the kind of global economic sector in terms of understanding and trying to create a universe away from the normal kind of fiat, you know, the kind of the coins and centralized bank and government controlled perspective. And I'm not going to go into the economic political perspective of that. One point to pick up on, and it's a question maybe that Saga, you could maybe answer as well. I mean, how inclusive is cryptocurrency? And I mean, we know that the connectivity is great. We know that, you know, there's lots of opportunity to be able to, you know, you know, if you have a mobile phone, how many people in the world have a mobile phone of some sort that actually could have hold a wallet and could hold cryptocurrency? You know, this decentralized opportunity, it's potentially also dangerous because we know the volatility often within cryptocurrencies mean that, you know, if you're living in a relatively tight economic situation where you can't afford to realistically lose money, you know, cryptocurrency is probably not the best bet. Even stable coins have proven to kind of have some issues around this. So, you know, with terms of inclusiveness, if we're going to kind of create this greater diversity around the world and bring people on board to have that greater impact, where can cryptocurrency actually offer that? Where can it actually step up to, as opposed to kind of existing in a bubble at the moment in some ways? And you know, I put my hands up, I hold probably a dozen or so different cryptocurrencies in a wallet, including Bitcoin, out of interest and experience. I want to understand more and more, and that one way to do it is to hold it. But I don't think I'm a good example of that. You know, how can we create that inclusiveness? How can we create that diversity which we can thrive on? How can it have that broader impact? I mean, appreciate you may not have the answer for that one, but it's an interesting question, I think.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think inclusiveness would start, and for inclusiveness to happen, we need to make a start. So just for instance, I remember in 2000s or 2001 or slightly even a couple of years back, as in 1998, in India, mobile phones were not something which was very common, and they were very expensive at that point in time. But since the private players, whoever were manufacturers, they pushed in, even though the demand was quite less at that point in time and the product was very expensive, but still, and if in your question, if I were to borrow your question, it was less inclusive. At that point in time, the telecom, the mobile phone, the whole mobile phone concept was less inclusive because very less people were using it at that point in time. But still, the whole system supported that particular technology and introduction of that technology. And slowly and steadily, we saw that the demand for mobile phones went up, the cost of mobile phones went down, and then that's the whole economics which took over. And today we have a brilliant teledensity right now. And like you were just discussing like some time back, that there are companies which have come, which are offering the telecom services, including data services, at a very low rate. And therefore now even the person standing at the last in the queue also has a smartphone or a mobile phone and is well connected. So from 2000 to 2021, the journey which we have traveled from very less demand for mobile phones to apparently, I think, the largest market of mobile phones in the world, or one of the largest markets of the mobile phones in the world, is something phenomenal. So I am expecting something like this in the crypto space also. Maybe not as a currency, but definitely as an asset. So people have more avenues of investing. Foreign institutional investors have more avenues of investing, and the government itself would come out with its own digital currency. So that is also something which would be an alternative to the private cryptocurrencies. And who knows, that capital markets are so booming right now in India. The Indian stock market capitalization is set to overtake the market capitalization of the London Stock Exchange. Who knows that, say, 20 years, 25 years, 30 years down the line, even the crypto market environment could be very encouraging and could be very booming. Yeah.
I agree. I think the opportunity is there to create inclusiveness. But I think, you know, the comment David Goldsmith has just made in the comments kind of hits it on the head. You know, it's been more of an opportunity for the few to make a lot more money. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm kind of narrowing down the perspective here. But that you know, there is a view. You know, when I go out, if I walked down our local high street and asked every single person, have you before or do you currently hold any kind of cryptocurrency, including Bitcoin? I would be surprised if I met anybody who did. I live in a town that has quite a broad social kind of economic and cultural area, different races and ethnicities and things. You know, we're not massively kind of diverse, but we have, you know, enough to be able to create an interesting kind of soundbite. And Aruda, I noticed there was a question from Peter actually about the metaverse. Yeah, I mean, I just wondered whether that would be quite an interesting kind of comment to pick up, kind of, you know, bring the conversation forward, because I think this is something really interesting.
Yeah, I was just looking at that, Stuart, and I think I'll just read out the question. It says, with the new metaverse from Facebook, what are the panel's views on how diversity can or will be addressed, or is it just a new buzz to distract from their internal issues? I think it's a very interesting questions. I mean, we were also, when we were discussing yesterday, we were thinking, you know, diversity is something which is on paper and inclusion is a mindset. I mean, is it actually happening on ground? Is something that we all need to, you know, think about. Also, we have also seen that how diversity and inclusion, they're increasingly being taken into account for also ESG evaluation. If an organization is doing very well, then it is also valued very well for the ESG funding. And it is also obviously a very good factor to measure and attract talent and promote employee engagement and brand value. Let's hear from the both of you what you think about it. We also have another question. Okay, yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
I think on this, the topic which we are discussing, which is diversity and SDG goals, technology definitely helps, but at the same time, even the local support, the local administration's support, and the mindset, like you said, that inclusion is a mindset, is definitely very critical. So if technology and the mindset of inclusion, if we couple that together, then that would go on a long way in achieving the sustainable development goals. Having said that, the reality is we definitely have made considerable progress. You can take any region in the world, any developing or developed region in the world. We have been making progress, whether it's the infrastructure sector, whether it's decent and affordable and clean energy sector. We have initially oil or probably the other fossil fuels were the main sources of energy. And now with innovation and technological advancement, we definitely have figured out various clean means of generating and distributing energy. So even in energy sector, in the infrastructure sector, I think as a human race and as regions, even if we see regions in silos, we have made considerable progress, and the administrations have been responding well to these goals. The question which still remains is the pace at which they are responding is satisfactory or not? And there we can have our own opinions and differences. Some may say that yes, given the other situations and other factors and parameters, they are responding satisfactorily, and some may say maybe not. So that's the debate which is going on right now. On the metaverse question, I think now that's something, again, which is technology, and moreover, it is innovation in the technical field. Now, how it unfolds and how the sovereign across the world respond to that is something which is the key and which would depend on how well the governments around the world understand the concept of metaverse and how quickly they understand and adapt to this technological advancement which is taking place. It's the blockchain technology. Many of the countries in the world may still be wondering what that particular technology is. We're talking about not so advanced and not so developed countries. But some of us have definitely taken some sort of lead and are implementing and are making sure that we are not left behind. So I think that's going to be more or less the same with metaverse as well. That's my opinion.
Just taking a step back, Sagar and Stuart here, I mean, I think what Peter questions also pointed out towards the internal issues, right? And especially, you know, in a country like ours, we have also seen, okay, I can't. Stuart, we have also seen the laws for the minorities, equal wages. You know, in India, those laws are there. But most of them, they don't even know that these laws exist. So it's not that the constitution is not there, the regulation is not there, but most of the people are not even aware of these laws. And I mean, let alone taking an action, but you know, they don't even know about these laws. How do they go about it? I think the internal issue about, you know, when we're talking about such a huge topic and we're talking about technological innovations, I think it is also very pertinent that we point out the foundational, you know, the foundational loopholes that there are. You know, the people are not really able to avail any of the, like, equal. I mean, you know, very recently I also figured out there's something for equal wages. And that is something that, you know, so I was hoping if Sagar could shed lights, because there are a lot of laws which actually helps the diversity in an organization and not just, you know, at home. And yeah, but I think Sagar's internet is.
So well, I think he's still there, but I think he's lost his camera because I can see he hit the three green dots. But anyway, just to come back on the cynic in me says that metaverse, this kind of change is a little bit of a kind of an opportunity to try and clean up the act of Facebook or try and kind of brush it under the carpet. That's the cynic in me. I'm not a big Facebook user, never have been, but I do like social media. So I think I want to kind of take, I think the metaverse is something I'm trying to get my head around a little bit in terms of that. You know, technology has the opportunity to create, connect diversity. I think that's where we need to look at it. I don't think it necessarily is going to solve the problems. I think we still, as a human race, need to solve the problems. And I think just looking at David's comment on that, and Peter's agreement, and I have to say, yeah, I'm there with him. I think what we've talked about so far is about what we want to achieve, but actually in the real world, I don't think that's what's happening. And I think human nature will always be the kind of the driver that picks up with that. And so therefore the challenge is how we try and maybe prevent this kind of issue around that. I mean, there is around kind of climate change, species extinction. This is going on and this is not stopping. In the time we have this conversation over 45 minutes, I'm not going to quote how many species have suddenly become extinct, but there's a number there. That's not good enough. You know, the world has increased by a fraction of centigrade, whatever it is in climate. Things are happening. We need a different approach to this. I don't think we can do what we did 100 years ago or even probably 20 years ago to solve this issue. But I think what we've tried to outline today is that there is an opportunity here to actually find a place where we could actually thrive on this diversity. It's not necessarily going to resolve the underlying problems though, and that's where I have concerns. And I think this is where we need to kind of consider it from a societal position. So does the metaverse kind of help with that? I don't really think so. Again, the cynic in me comes that, you know, all social media has an economic driver behind it. You know, whether you're on the platform for free and using it and enjoying that connectivity is a kind of a bonus in some ways. And I think that really helps. The bottom line with this is that, you know, I think actually social media tends to dilute it. So what you find is you're getting this not necessarily greater connectivity just happening, but you're diluting the differences. And I think that could be one of the big perspectives going forward, whether the metaverse has the ability to resolve that matter and allow that. But that then reverses back to what Dave was saying. You know, it creates kind of, you know, we are creating silos. There's kind of, you know, and, you know, part of it. In business, we talk about not, you know, breaking out silos, you know, about how we kind of diversify through our kind of our businesses, our firms, and generate kind of cross connections and talkings and all that kind of perspectives. But in society, is there a purpose behind having those to some extent as well, where we can protect identities? Where we can maybe look at, I think one of the things we talk about here is, you know, this kind of the kind of ethnic minorities. You know, is there a way we can kind of work with that as well? So we've got to kind of consider this. I think we need to kind of spend some time kind of over this and try and decide where that becomes a kind of quite important. You know, so yeah, I mean, it's a challenging time for us in that sense, definitely.
Definitely, and I think democratization is so important for diversity to be there. Just having one player never really does it. So, you know, I feel when where the Googles and the Facebooks of the world, even, you know, that the data needs to be democratized. And I think that's what, you know, Stuart, you are doing with your lot of, you know, multiple initiatives. And that's what we are also trying to do with water, that... because the moment there's democratization, there is diversity. You know, a democratic country, it thrives on diversity. And that is why it is very, very important that, you know, that's a part of the discussion. And, you know, Sagar, you had gone offline, but we're just discussing this that, you know, in India, I mean, somebody asked Peter asked a very interesting question, is that are we actually looking at the internal issues? The whole buzz that we are talking about technology, it's something, you know, something that we are doing for the future. But let's talk about the present scenario, right? Even when it comes to India, you know, the Indian law, I mean, there are laws which concerns minorities. There are laws which concerns equal pay. But I mean, how much are they being really taken care of? How much, I mean, you know, nobody really goes to the HR and asks that, you know, I should be paid equally. And it's a fact that in India, you know, women are not paid as much as men, right? And it's not that the law is not there, but people are not really taking actions towards it. And I think even taking actions will enable diversity. You know, if women are paid equally, or even the minority groups are paid equally, they'll be more encouraged to join the workforce. You know, right now we see as we climb up the ladder, there are very, very few women in the leadership position. There are very few minority groups in the leadership positions. And that is also because they don't know their rights and what to ask for. We all are hesitant to go to the HR and ask because we ourselves don't know that, you know, there is such law that we can, you know, avail. And I'm sure, Sagar, that, you know, you could shed some light on it, because I think Peter's question was very, very relevant, that we are talking about diversity, but are we distracting ourselves from the internal issues? You know, we are talking about all this growth, but is that actually happening? I mean, climate change, it's more real than ever, right? We also saw recently one of the prime ministers of the country delivering talk while being in water, just to send a message across. I mean, you know, that was such an interesting visual that, you know, we all are going to be.
Right. No, I definitely think that laws are something which can be made, and that definitely showcases in the intent of the parliamentarians who are responsible for framing and drafting and passing the laws. So that reflects their mindset. So what the law is something that reflects the mindset of the people who made that particular law. That's point number one. Then we come to the important part, that's the implementation part. Now when we come to the implementation part, a lot depends on the mindset of two key proponents. First is the person who is the beneficiary of that particular law. So say, for example, if I were to take the equality at workplace, the laws which govern equality at workplace, then whoever is being discriminated becomes the beneficiary of that particular law. And his or her mindset is something on which the implementation of that particular law would depend. Now say, for instance, you said that who goes to the HR? Now, if nobody goes to the HR, the law would not be set in motion automatically. Someone needs to go and make sure that the law is set in motion. And then that depends on the mindset of the beneficiary. The second is the one who is supposed to adjudicate on how the law is to be interpreted, which in our system is the judiciary. And the judiciary has been interpreting these social the laws, or so, which we call them social beneficial laws or legislation, they are the ones which the judiciary has interpreted in a very liberal way, and to some extent even in a way which many have termed as judicial activism. But I personally think that is something which is very necessary in a vibrant democracy. The other point which I want to make with respect to this question and the observation which you made, Anuradha, with respect to leadership roles which women are on today and many other factors or wherever women have reached, I would just say that let's just pause for a minute and go 20 years back and then do a comparison with what their status in terms of the society, in terms of workplace was 20 years ago and what it is today. And if we get an answer or if we get an answer that yes, today they are better, then one thing we can be sure of is that we are going in the right direction, at least. That's something which we can be sure of in that case, if we are definitely better than what we were 20 years ago. And the only question which remains to be answered is whether we could have covered the distance in 10 years, what we have covered in 20 years. That's the question that we need to address. And that question would be addressed by fine-tuning the processes, by making sure that the processes which are involved are efficient. So just for an instance, which you said about going to the HR, now if there is a process in place wherein the whole process of finding out the truth or making sure that you get equal pay for equal work, if that whole process is expedited in a particular manner, then I'm sure we could have covered the distance in 10 years instead of 20. So my perspective on that, a lawyer's perspective, is that because we have what we require, it's just that implementation and the processes which are involved in implementation of those particular laws is something which needs to be fine-tuned, and last but not the least, the intent or the mindset of those who need to kick the whole legal process into motion and the mindset and intent of those who are there to adjudicate.
You're on mute.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah. So no, I think we definitely made progress, but there's a long, long way to go.
Right.
And, you know, I think David's comment is bang on, and that's why I think, you know, there's a very strong need to read that out. He says the underlying mechanism, algorithms, constructs are not structured for inclusion. Their primary purpose is economic. Humanity needs to redefine what is human. Today, the movement is to take someone from poverty to consumerism, which is unsustainable. I mean, you know, we're talking about the algorithms and how the technology is moving towards, you know, the include. It's an open-ended question. So I don't expect any of us to have an answer because, I mean, there's no right or wrong answer to this. But, I mean, how much is it really about inclusion? I think that's what we can leave our audience with, this thought on the table. And how much is it only for the economic growth? I mean, we all understand, we all might have seen Social Dilemma on Netflix, and we all know how algorithms, and not just, I mean, you know, here we are not naming one organization, it's with everything that's happening, right? Every behavior is getting tracked. There's a digital blueprint of everything that you're doing at the moment, and how much is actually for inclusion and how much it's actually for consumerism is something that we all need to think about, and what is the fine line between the two. And, you know, where does the data privacy actually kicks in? And I think that is all, that is another war that we'll be fighting over the next decade, I'm very sure. Yeah. Last comments, Stuart? Last comments, Sagar?
I was quite interested in David's comment actually at the end about I think his male power. Yes, I'm going to put some thought to that one, David. I think we need to find this balance. One area we didn't quite kind of pick up with was around the kind of opportunity for entrepreneurial and SME growth, you know, and how we can understand where maybe, you know, sectors of society are underfunded and how we can kind of see diversity as a tool and maybe to be able to leverage that to the benefit of society. Again, it's economic. But Hannah, I don't think we should shy away from that. I don't think we should, you know, I think sometimes we kind of shift too much towards kind of saying we need to kind of ditch all that and become, you know, more well, almost kind of hippie-like in our approach to these things. I think, you know, we need to be more smart about, you know, going back to what we were saying earlier, more smart about the way we approach this and how we see diversity as something which can benefit the economies around the world. But also part of that diversity is around how we can actually move to a different way of delivering on this so that we're not in a situation where we are having to rethink again the way society works. This is our chance now to do that. And I think we mustn't mitigate that with one way or the other. We need to find that balance in place. And actually, it leads me to my final quote, which someone sent me actually whilst we're in this conversation. It was a quote from Star Trek. Mr. Spock said once, infinite diversity in infinite combinations, symbolizing the elements that create truth and beauty. I think that encapsulates probably everything we've spoken about in the last 45 minutes. But anyway, Saga, I will move. Let you have your final comment.
I just have one small last comment, which is that I seriously hope that when we meet again for Rasset Asia meeting 2031, probably we will have made considerable progress with respect to all these SDGs. And I hope that we will be discussing that how quick we have covered the distance rather than that we are slow. So let's just on that note of hope, I think it's a good note to sign off.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Stuart and Sagar, for being on the panel. I think it has been an insightful, and we discussed an array of topics, not only gender inclusivity, but also talking about inclusivity in space of technology and, you know, the other aspects. Thank you so much. I look forward to staying in touch with the both of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Take care. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.